There he is on the left, on the left.
There he is. Yeah. There he is, see him on the left rigger, left rigger. Have a go. There he goes. Nah. He's back on. There he is. It's a strike.
Yep, there
we go.
On a recent trip to New South Wales, I caught up with a couple of fishing buddies from Sydney, Dan Rodriguez and James Thackray. With a great weather forecast, we decided to spend the day game fishing offshore.
Alrighty, it's an absolutely beautiful day and we're about 50 kilometres offshore of Sydney, Broken Bay to be more precise. And I'm fishing today with my very good friend James Thackray from Black Pete Marine. Now James, you and I have fished together a fair bit over the years, but would it be fair to say that today we're chasing probably what is your and my favourite species?
Yeah, definitely mate, going for the old blue marlin and hopefully yellowfin.
That's
it. At this time of the year still you can get, you know, black marlin as well, occasional striped marlin.
Sure.
You know, so yeah, hopefully we get a good blue, but normally when the water temperature's a bit down like this in April, quite often you get your bigger blues as well. You might not get the numbers that you normally get, but you can get your bigger fish, so.
Beautiful. And the difference with this sort of fishing to your striped marlin fishing that you often see us doing in the black marlin, which is on the inside edge of the shelf, we're now out over the canyons, and it's all about pulling lures, isn't it?
Yeah, it's pulling lures. And the good thing about pulling lures, opposed to, you know, like it's good to get striped marlin fishing or that with your skip baits and that, but, you know, with your live baits, quite often you miss the bite. One of the best things about blue marlin, other than, you know, once they get them on and going crazy, is the actual bite. So
yep,
always want to be looking at the lures and all that sort of thing. If you, quite often you actually don't see them come up. If you think you've seen something, you quite often keep looking at that lure
and then
bang, like, you know, like insane bites all the time. It's such a great way, you know, to go marlin fishing.
Absolutely love doing this stuff today. It's all about the heavy tackle. We've got the big Makaira's, the 80-pound line. Let's get some gear in the water and try and find one of these.
Sounds
things
good, mate.
James getting lures in the water. I've just got to drop this rigger out. We've got the tag lines on today because we're lure fishing. We're going to put this bullet out on the outrigger. You can run them anywhere, but on the outrigger is really good, and that looks a lot like a souris. And at the moment, there's plenty of souris kicking around this area, so there's a fair chance that'll get eaten. So James, the thing I find really interesting in fishing is that guys walk into the tackle store and a lure like that is hanging on the wall and guys go, oh, what are you fishing for, Moby Dick and stuff like that.
Yeah.
And sure, that's a big lure, but in the scheme of it, that's no more than a big slimy mackerel.
Yeah.
And these blues, they're eating yellowfin tuna and stuff, aren't they?
Yeah, exactly right. So you want to sort of like, a lot of the time when you're blue marlin fishing or any form of fishing, you want to sort of like change your lure size, obviously colours as well. So,
yep,
you know, you might run a lure like this sort of size here, around about 14 inches long off your corners or something like that. It's always worth putting something smaller like that. It's about a 10-inch lure,
yep,
off your riggers, you know, because, you know, especially like a few flying fish around, that sort of stuff, sort of try and match the size of the bait, but always worth having a couple of big ones out and mixing it up a bit as well.
That's,
you know,
it. The other one I noticed 2 years ago, we always had big double hook rigs, but now a lot of what we're doing is with a single hook rig like that. Can you show people exactly how you position that hook in that skirt to make it swim better?
Yeah, well, generally what you do, there's a couple of different ways depending on the lure. Some lures have like little black stoppers at the back. This one here is one of Lee's lures, and he's put a little bit of wax thread there, as you can see. By putting the wax thread there, the hole at the back of the lure, when you jab it up there, it will sort of stay in. The best way we find to do it is sort of line up the hook with the bottom like that, and then sort of pull it tight, and then it's sort of stuck in there like that. And obviously when you get a fish on or something like that, it will release and be a lot more free flowing in that.
And so, you're running it hooked down too.
Yeah, hooked down. The thing with the hook down is when the fish sort of, like, especially with blue marlin, when they come up and bite it and they turn, as they turn, you know, the hook will roll over. So we found that we're getting a better hook up that way opposed to upwards.
Beautiful.
And the other thing as well, with like a single hook, you'll probably find your lure trucks a little better opposed to a double hook. And also better for the fish and safety. You get something like a mahi-mahi, which you'll get on lures like this. Very dangerous with two hooks, you know.
That's it.
Yeah.
Get it in the water and let's hopefully get it dangerously into a marlin's mouth. So Dan, to get the best out of your Simrad Evo 3s, you can turn them on and they work absolutely beautifully, but like anything, if you take the time to learn it, yep, you can get heaps more out of it. Can you show people quickly how you can set your high and your low chirp at once, run both different transducers and get the best out of them in this situation here, say blue marlin fishing?
Not a problem. So at the moment we've got high chirp. So high chirp's good for your shallow water stuff. So anything up to that 150 to 200 metres, But yeah, we want to run a split screen. So we want to run a high and a low chirp because we want to see what's down deep. So if we press the pages button up the top here, you can see that we've already split up a dual transducer setup here. Yep. So a high and a low frequency. So you can see here we've got the high and we've got the low.
Yep. Now, just quickly, your low chirp is much better for the deeper water stuff. That's what we use to mark feed layers for swordfish or for big blue eye and all that sort of stuff. This one is our shallower water, more surface layer stuff, isn't it?
Yeah, that's correct. So a lot of this deep down stuff is not as, you know, we're not going to be using it. We've got the low chirp for that. So let's just focus on that top 150 meters. So if we go into the button up here, and then we can actually change the range from, instead of being 300 meters, we can change it to 150 meters. So therefore it's just going to focus on that top part of the water.
Sure. And is that just giving us a better view of what's going on in that area?
Yeah, so whatever's in that 150 meter water column, yeah, we're going to see it a lot clearer.
And the reality is that any marlin or tuna at 150 is catchable. Anything that's down 300 or 400, we're probably not going to be able to catch it anyway.
That's right.
Good fish. Get that shotgun in. There it is over there. There it is, Clarky. Shotgun in.
That's what we're after. We've jumped off two fish today. Oh, look at him go. We've had two shots on blue marlin today. There's a bit of bait in this area. And every bite has come. Dan, you want to just tap her off a bit, mate? Every bite has come out of this small area, and you follow the basic principle in game fishing, marlin fishing: find the bait, find the fish. When you find that bait,
that's a good bite too, eh?
Don't leave it. That was a real good bite. Look at him wigging out the back there, mate. I'll just swap him around. Look at him go. How's that, James? We just swapped that lure over.
Yeah.
To that little smash bait, which looks a lot like a baby tuna.
Randy was talking about it, weren't we?
Get this bucket on James, get him all sorted. You right, mate?
Yeah.
Check this out, this is so good. You can scroll back on your footage and do several things. There are those two marks. Guarantee one of those is our marlin. And then if I just press that, we've saved it. It's on the GPS. I better get back to James. See here, James is just taking it nice and steady. We're in a bit of a stalemate at the moment. He's using the lean post or the fighting station to have a break, put the heat on the fish using his actual body weight to break this fish. Everything okay?
Yep, sweet.
Beautiful. So you can see here the way the boat's designed and the thought that's been put into it, that Dan was able to stay on the wheel, which is really important. James was on the rod and I was able to clear the deck in a very short space of time. Lures are unclipped over there, tag poles out, gloves are ready, everything's ready, but most of all, we've got a clean workspace. And that makes life so much easier.
And it's safer.
Safer. The other thing that's important to learn or to do if you're getting into game fishing, get yourselves a good set of tracing gloves. These are my AFCO ones. They're a bit beaten up, that's from leadering fish, but that's what they're made for. They've got a lot of strength through this back of the hand area and down the sides. Cotton outers because they get shredded and I can just replace them. But the most important thing when you get a fish on, wet the glove. Because when you wrap on that leader, it'll stop it from actually burning. And if you burn the leader, you weaken it, and then you can lose your fish. So wet your gloves, that's a great tip. There's a double. You see here too what James has done. He's put himself into the back corner of the boat and he's actually got his knees either side of that corner, bracing himself in and locking himself in, because if he was back here at this point with the fish being close, he's going to be potentially putting that line just too close to the back corner of the boat and trim tabs and things like that. There's that Dacron. Just going to edge him up. Keep pulling around, Dan. Bit more, mate.
Bit more.
Bit more, bit more. Faster, faster, faster.
Yeah, it's better, that's cool.
Faster, dude.
Let go if you have to.
Is it a strike? It's a big strike. That's why he looks so good on the bite, with that big dorsal.
Its jumps were a bit different, weren't they, to the
average blue? Yeah, quite as crazy. Wait. Boom. Keep going. Definitely a strike. Gonna go again. Oh, he's done all the right stuff for us at the boat. Look at that, that single hook. Beautifully in the corner of the jaw. You alright, bud?
Sorry.
You alright? Alrighty. And the great thing about this, and James explained it this morning, that single hook, much safer for us. Comes straight out. That's out, mate. You won't let him go?
May as well.
He's off.
That's good.
Look at him go. Well done, mate.
Happy days.
Well done, James.
Well done, mate. Nice.
Thank you. Thanks.
Well done, Dan. Man.
Well done, bud.
Cool.
Well done, Clarky. Thanks for filming it.
Happy day.
Let's go catch a blue.
Yeah.
There is absolutely no denying James and I love lure fishing, but one of the things in lure fishing is that thing there, the prop wash. When you're trolling skirted lures, there's a couple of key things you need to do. The first thing that I like to make sure, James, is that my lures are actively swimming. They're not lazy, spending too much time under the water and not skipping across the top. But what's a couple of other things that you like to look for?
Mate, some of the other things you're looking for is like your lures, for instance, being in as clear a water as possible.
Yep.
Like it's a lot better, especially like we had that blue marlin up before. We were doing a turn, it was in the prop wash. We missed the bite on a nice fish. You know, it's not as visual, it's not as easy for the fish marlin to see the lure. So that could have been a reason we missed it. It looked like it hit up near the head there. And also like it's, when it's up like that, just basically looks more attractive to our naked eye, so sure. You can imagine what it looks like to the fishes.
That's exactly right. If it doesn't look good to you or us, it probably doesn't look that good to them, does it?
And that's right, and we love looking at lures, don't we?
Certainly do. Now, when we've been marlin fishing the last few months, a lot of what we've been doing, skip baiting, live baiting, things like that. So we use the outriggers and we use that little clip, the pin clip up on the end of the outrigger. But for lure fishing, we use the tag line. The tag line takes out the drop back because when the fish eats the lure pretty quickly, he goes, that's not real. So we'll try and spit it out. So if we have the lure going up to there and then out, fish will grab it before the line comes tight. He'll drop the lure in many cases, not always. So the tag line's going to take that out. I'm going to show you how it works. It's very simple, very effective, and especially on species like tuna. First of all, lure's in the position we want. We've got a rubber band. Get it, and you wrap it around the line. The one thing that I learned in game fishing early on, if you do something, do it properly. If you're wrapping rubber bands, wrap them tight. You don't want them to slip. So I'm holding one end, and I'm getting the other end, and we're wrapping it like that. 8 times. Okay. That now is not going to move, because if that slides, it can actually burn the line and weaken it. I put my two ends together like that, and then I've got this piece of Dacron off the end of my tag line. We're just going to go straight through the two ends of the bands like that, and then I'm going to do a little half hitch like that. We don't want to pull this tag all the way through, because if I need to, I pull that tag, the whole lot comes undone. But for now, I've got this ready. We let that go. Reel goes into free spool. And the weight and the pressure of that lure pulls the tag line up and out. So what we're getting is still the lift and the spread from the outrigger, but instead of the line going out and then like that, it's going in like that. When that gets a bite, the band snaps and that rod instantly loads up. Before you put your lure in the water, give it a check, position that hook where you want it to sit, make sure nothing's tangled, no chafing, everything's right. And don't throw it in, just lean over and place it in the water. Just throw it, you could potentially get it tangled.
There he is on the left, on the left.
There he is. Yeah. There he is. See him on the left rigger, left rigger. Have a go. There he goes. Nah. He's back on. There he is. It's a strike.
Yep, there
There we go. How's that? We haven't had this gear back in the water for 5 minutes and we're on again. Whoa. There we go. Pretty common theme in fishing, isn't it, James? You catch a fish, go back to where you caught your last fish.
Yeah.
And get another one straight away.
Should have had a drink of water before I got this one on.
All I ever hear from you is complaining. Oh, I'm thirsty. Oh, my arms hurt. Oh, I've got to mind in all the fish. Oh.
You can smell that.
Bit of a kill.
Kill going on somewhere.
What James is talking about, that he can smell something with the kill slick. See that patch of calm water there? That's where predators, whether it's fish or whales and dolphins and stuff, have been eating food, fish. As they chew it all up, obviously, there's fish oils and stuff, it floats to the surface and you can smell it. Generally means that there's good fishing to be had.
Yeah, and quite often when you see a kill slick, if you're not hooked up like we are, it's a good idea to head over and work that area.
Have you still got a heap of line out or?
No, it's just here, the fish are just here.
James, when you're fighting a big fish on game tackle or heavy tackle, what's the key things you sort of concentrate or make sure that you do with your body so you don't tire out in 6 seconds?
Oh mate, well at the moment I'm sort of obviously not using a harness because hopefully it's a shorter fight and the fish is near the boat in case you need to lift the rod over, but realistically you're best off using your body weight opposed to your forearm.
Straight back.
Straight back, yeah.
And just short pump?
Main thing is just, especially going up and down with the swell, just keeping it in the line tight all the time.
Yes. I think people often don't realise that you use the swell to your advantage. As it goes up, you come down, and even if you get half a wine as you come down a swell, you still gain 6 inches of line. This guy's digging in now.
Might come up here, I reckon.
Hey.
Oh, and it's doing the little windscreen wiper that we were just talking about again.
Don't do that. That's often when they get off. Thinks he's a swordfish.
Very aggressive.
Very rubbery.
Very aggressive predator. See that? Just flicked off the side of its mouth again then.
Oi! A bit of a show. Come up, come up. A bit lit up, a bit angry. Interesting fact. Striped marlin's the only marlin that can actually alternate its stripes. So see how it's got silver stripes? It can also change them to black stripes, whereas every other marlin can only have one colour of stripe. That's it. Job done. That's a good thing about having something like these fold up. Relaxed bases too. It's nice and quick. Fold the rigger up just like that. Put the metal loop over and it's out of the way. It's like he's hooked under the chin or something.
Yeah, I definitely felt the line move a bit during the fight.
Yeah. Hey, hey, not me boat. Settle. Settle, you silly sausage.
Get that lure, Leroy.
There we go. Job done.
Oh, lure back on all.
How good's that?
You!
That hook.
Happy days.
It was just in the side of his face.
How good's that?
Well done, mate.
Nice work.
Top work. Well done, Dan.
Yeah, well done. Well done, man.
Nice.
Yeah, it was literally just in like the side of his cheek. And sometimes with marlin, you just get him.
That's it.
All right, fellas, I have an idea. You've both put in, we've caught fish today. It's been heaps and heaps of fun, as it always is. I owe you boys dinner and a few drinks. What say we get the gear in and head home?
Let's do it.